Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Stanford University's Frost Amphitheater. Please note this event will be filmed and webcast live. Personal photography and recording equipment of any kind are prohibited. For the enjoyment and safety of all, we ask that you please silence your electronic devices. Please take a moment to identify the nearest marked exit in case of emergency. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
Welcome to the inauguration of Stanford's 11th president. The inauguration of a new leader is an important community-wide ritual. This ceremony marks the transition of Marc Tessier-Lavigne from one status to another as he takes up office. Today, as we celebrate this occasion in words and music, so we will witness that transition symbolically as Professor Tessier-Lavigne exchanges his PhD robe for the presidential robe of Stanford and formally becomes President Tessier-Lavigne. Of course, this ritual is not only about Marc, who formally takes up office today. It also acknowledges the ongoing transformation of our community. We who are gathered here, students, staff, faculty, trustees, alums, friends of Stanford, are witnesses and celebrators of this occasion. And in gathering to share this moment, we acknowledge that we are a community. We are a diverse community with differences to be acknowledged, learned about, and celebrated. We strive for unity in our diversity. And so, as we forge common values of excellence in research, learning, and teaching, we also commit to compassion, empathy, and understanding in our encounters with one another. And as we strive for success and exercise our leadership, may we remain alive to beauty, attentive to suffering, kind to all. What do we need for this moment of possibility? The American poet Elizabeth Alexander puts it like this, quote, "Some live by love thy neighbor as thyself. Others by first do no harm or take no more than you need. What if the mightiest word is love? Love beyond marital, filial, national. Love that casts a widening pool of light. Love with no need to preempt grievance." In today's sharp sparkle, this autumn air, anything can be made. Any sentence begun, on the brink, on the brim, on the cusp, praise song for walking forward in that light. And so, as we celebrate the beginning of Marc Tessier-Lavigne's tenure as president, we acknowledge the challenges of our times and the opportunities before all of us. in gathering for this ceremony on the brink, on the brim, on the cusp of new times, we offer him our support and our gratitude as we all walk forward together in the light of the California sun. And so let the ritual of inauguration begin.
We've Good morning. On behalf of the university, and especially on behalf of the three former presidents present here today, Don Kennedy, John Hennessy, and me, Gerhard Kasper, I warmly welcome all of you, and in particular, our alumni who have come home for reunion weekend. Today is a joyous, yes. Today is a joyous occasion because for the 11th time, and I should probably say only for the 11th time, since David Starr Jordan took office 125 years ago, Stanford greets a new president. It is my very great privilege to welcome Marc Tessier-Lavigne as the 11th president of the university. After the great Wallace Stirling, you, Mr. President, are the second person of Canadian origin to occupy the Stanford presidency. Indeed, both Wally Stirling and you were born in Ontario. I will state, but that by comparison with all of your predecessors, Jordan, Brenner, Wilbur, Treseder, Stirling, Pitzer, Lyman, Kennedy, Casper, and Hennessy, your Franco-Ontarian name is the longest and hardest to pronounce. That may be to your advantage rather than disadvantage. It seems to me that it was easier to wonder publicly, what is Casper up to, than what is Tessier-Lavigne up to? Especially if you are baffled by the pronunciation. I also warmly welcome Mary Hines, Mark's wife, like her husband, a neuroscientist. Of the three children who are all present here today, Christian, Kyle, and Ella. Ella is a Stanford freshman. She was early admitted to Stanford way before her father. I hope, Ella, I will be the very last person who makes reference to the fact that you are related to the Stanford president. We are very pleased to greet Mark's mother, Sheila Tessier-Lavigne, and other members of the Tessier-Lavigne and Hines families. Mark, I have just returned from a Europe-wide conference. They did that to me too, all the time. It's very hard, at least no helicopter as yet. Mark, I have just returned from a Europe-wide conference on how university governance can facilitate creativity. On the second day of the conference, somebody asked, why is everybody always talking about Stanford? I do not think the questioner had anything to do with Harvard. You are becoming president at a time when Stanford ranks high in the world of higher education. When I say Stanford ranks high, I do, of course, not refer to university and college rankings, which, like I hope, everybody else in this audience, I abhor. I simply refer to the fact that all over the world, people respect the seriousness and quality of Stanford's work in teaching, learning, and research, both undergraduate and graduate. But you are also becoming president when there is much political, religious, economic, military, social, and intellectual strife around the world. Die Luft der Freiheit, the wind of freedom, is not blowing as strongly as many of us would hope. An era of what is identified as perish the thought, post-truth politics seems to be upon us. More than ever do universities need to focus on what in Quattrocento Italy in the 15th century was called studia humanitatis, studies of humanity. In order to understand the human condition, human circumstances, thought, beliefs, values, as they find their expression in different cultural traditions, in different societies, and at different times. Your university is superbly positioned to engage in the rigorous tradition and pursuit of knowledge, the rigorous search for truth, even contemplation. We thank you for having become a trustee of these values.
And on this occasion, I have the privilege today of reading a part of the speech which Jane Stanford, the co-founder of this university, prepared for its opening day in October 1891. She wrote the speech, but she never gave it. She was overcome by emotion on that day, and at the bottom of her text, she wrote later, "Not read as I expected, as I did not have the courage on that opening day." And so I'm especially honored to read her words that she didn't read on this wonderful day when all around us is the clear evidence of the words and dreams and courage that she did have. Here are some of Jane Stanford's words. "Our hearts have been more deeply interested in this work than you can conceive. It was born in sorrow, but it has now become a great joy to our hearts. I desire to impress upon the minds of each one of these students, male and female, that we have at heart and very closely the hope that you will each strive to place before yourselves a high standard, that you will resolve to go forth from your classrooms determined in the future to be leaders, that you will live such lives that it will be said of you that you are true to the best that you know. I hope your lives will be truly earnest, but not in the sense of going forth to acquire wealth or a great name, but to be conscientious workers, to be helpful to others, to send cheer and goodwill to those who need lifting up. And perhaps it will not be improper for me to say to these young men and women who have gathered here today that this day is held by us as one of the most sacred of our lives. We thought it a sacred day when we laid the cornerstone of this institution, Stanford, and how often we've wondered if it would be our Heavenly Father's will to allow us to remain on earth to witness its inauguration. I think we both feel a personal and individual interest in every one of you. In fact, it seems to me that you have become part of our lives. Our hearts have yearned for a work which might rouse our interest in the life of the young, and in this field, our hearts are filled almost to overflowing with the deepest interest. While we are permitted to remain in this life, we will closely follow the results when you go forth to battle with the world. There is only one failure that you could have, and that is not to be true to the best you know. Always be gentle in manner, resolute in purpose, and you will develop characters on which others will depend. And you can safely dispense with all those more brilliant qualities if you can be depended upon for truthfulness, for honesty of purpose, and for each example of a good student that I know will reach out and have an undying influence. One who has passed away from this earth has said, kind words, generous acknowledgement, ready appreciation, and unselfish delight in the excellence of others. Those are the best signs of a large intellect and a noble spirit. To be true and to be loving is the secret. I hope every one of you will hold up this ideal, and then you will go forward into the world. It is what we wish and what we hope and what we pray for. Thank you.
Good morning. It is now my privilege to carry out the formal investiture of our new president, at which time we will present Marc Tessier-Lavigne with the Stanford robe. The tradition of academic robes dates back to the earliest times of universities. Centuries ago, robes were worn every day by students and faculty alike. Today, the academic robe, still worn at ceremonial occasions, helps us reflect upon the fact that universities are not just great institutions of history and heritage, but of lasting and enduring purpose. They hearken us back to the fundamental and time-honored principles. They remind us of our promise to create, to teach, and to learn. Challenge us to embrace service to others, honor our charge as citizens of the world. It is through the university that generations have drawn the past to chart the future. Stanford may be comparatively young in the pantheon of universities, but the values that guide it here today and for the years ahead are truly timeless. Marc has invited Eliza Adams, a graduate student in neuroscience, formerly in his lab at Rockefeller University, and now here at Stanford, to assist in the ceremony. She holds the traditional robe of the president. Marc, I invite you now to step forward for the formal investiture. By the authority of the Board of Trustees of this university, I hereby formally inaugurate you, Marc Tessier-Lavigne, as president of Stanford University. And as a visible symbol of your authority in that office, I now invest you with the robe of president. Congratulations to Marc.
Chairman Denning, Presidents Emeriti Hennessy, Casper, and Kennedy, Provost Etchemendi, members of the Board of Trustees, faculty colleagues, students, members of the staff, alumni, neighbors, friends, and family, thank you. Today, I'm privileged and humbled to join a small group of scholars asked to lead this great university. It's a tremendous responsibility, and I'm deeply honored to join their ranks. I'm also so pleased that my wife, Mary, my three children, and members of our immediate and extended family could be here. I especially want to acknowledge my mother, Sheila, who celebrated her 80th birthday just days ago. This was right on the heels of Stanford's 125th anniversary, two inspiring milestones. We must marvel at humanity's progress in the span of my mother's and the university's existence. We've made great advances in civil rights and human health. We've lifted millions out of poverty. We've traveled to the moon. We've uncovered ancient civilizations, and we've sequenced our genomes. And our world is more connected than ever, thanks to stunning technological advances. But our knowledge of the universe and of ourselves remains fragmentary, from the inner workings of the atom to the functioning of the brain to understanding our own biases. and we still confront challenges in many areas, including still untreatable disease, mounting environmental degradation, social injustice and global conflicts, and the continuing need to find ways to understand each other and to make authentic connections. What is the role of a university at times like this? What is the role of our university? I believe great research universities are a source of light and hope. They meet challenges head on. They are purposeful in advancing knowledge and human welfare. They're custodians of humanity's heritage and engines of societal advance. They are a major force in maintaining the world's upward arc of progress, even, perhaps especially, in the face of complex challenges like those confronting us today. Stanford embraces this ideal. When I reflect on Stanford's 125-year history, I see a university that has pressed forward through thick and thin, gaining in stature as a leader in education and scholarship to make increasingly important contributions to society and to human well-being. Thanks to over a century of inspired leadership, including by the distinguished presidents emeriti here today, Stanford has become the, quote, university of high degree that its founders envisioned. Stanford's preeminence derives from its bedrock dedication to education, research, and creativity for the benefit of humanity. But it also stems from its optimism, its resilience, and its courage to evolve. Its optimism is rooted in the pioneer culture of the West. Its resilience is reflected in the fight to keep the university afloat after the death of Leland Stanford, in its restoration after the damage of two earthquakes, in its decisive response to the recent economic meltdown. Its courage to evolve is demonstrated in countless initiatives. In the 1950s, it invested both in steeples of academic excellence and in public-private interactions. In the 60s and 70s, it elevated scholarship in race and ethnicity. In the 80s, it amplified public service. In the 90s, it rethought undergraduate education. In the 2000s, it kindled interdisciplinary inquiry. These attributes have propelled Stanford to be a leader among comprehensive research universities marked by excellence across the board in the arts, humanities, social sciences, sciences and engineering, in undergraduate, graduate, and professional education, in service, entrepreneurship, and also athletics. Stanford's first president, David Starr Jordan, said, "It is for us as teachers and students in the university's first year to lay the foundations of a school which may last as long as human civilization." Now, 125 years later, those foundations are firmly laid. Yet, there is a fundamental law of great institutions that they never stay the same. They move forward or they fall back. So as we look to the future, I want us to ask ourselves, are we doing all we can to build on our powerful foundation for future generations? Are we living up to our potential? Are we sufficiently advancing a purposeful university? What do I mean by a purposeful university? I mean a university that promotes and celebrates excellence not as an end in itself, but as a means to magnify its benefit to society. A university that relentlessly educates students to be global citizens and leaders, fosters unlimited creativity, and discovers and applies knowledge for the benefit of humanity. Given our great gifts, that is not just our mission, but also our responsibility to work to advance the social good boldly and confidently, but also with humility and empathy. That was the aim of Jane and Leland Stanford in establishing this university. The founding grant states, quote, "Its object to qualify its students for personal success and direct usefulness in life, and its purposes to promote the public welfare by exercising an influence on behalf of humanity and civilization. So I ask, what more can we do to be a purposeful university? Let's examine the key mainstays supporting our mission of benefiting humanity, our two central pillars, education and the generation and application of knowledge, and the foundation that supports them, our people and our culture. The first pillar is education. Here, we confront strong cultural forces that are driving students to specialize. Half a century ago, scientist and novelist C.P. Snow penned his famous essay deploring the growing chasm between what he'd called the two cultures, humanities and arts on one side, science and technology on the other. He worried that this division would impede solving the great problems confronting humanity. At the time, Snow was concerned about the second-class status of science. Today, the pendulum has swung. There is mounting pressure for a vocational focus, and STEM fields, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, are promoted by politicians concerned about the economy and parents concerned for their children's job prospects. In the face of this trend, we must reaffirm the importance and value of a broad or liberal education, liberal in the sense of liberating the mind. Today's students will change jobs frequently. The jobs available to them will evolve rapidly. Their careers will last over half a century, and they will have to work effectively with people from varied cultures and backgrounds. A broad-based education is their best preparation. Our recent study of undergraduate education identified key skills they will need: critical and moral reasoning, creative expression, appreciation of diversity, and crucially, the ability to adapt over a lifetime, all key in a world of accelerating change. Stanford's curriculum incorporates these insights, and our first priority must be to continue to execute on this plan. But exposing students to diverse disciplines isn't just about teaching skills. It's also about helping them understand the need to draw on diverse disciplines to be effective. Whether it is applying insights from the humanities, the arts, and the social sciences to improve product design for our engineers, or to inform compassionate patient care and disease prevention for our medical scientists, or conversely, applying data sciences to deepen our knowledge of history or literature for our humanists, or combining insights from psychology, neuroscience, and economics to understand human decision-making. At every turn, we see a blurring of disciplinary lines in problems our students will be tackling throughout their careers. This highlights all the more the importance of a broad education for our students. And so, we must help our students understand that, over the course of their life and career, the liberal is the vocational. To assist them, we must ensure that we don't unwittingly drive them to focus in particular areas. Our curriculum must allow students interested in history or psychology or political science, and also interested in technical fields, to experience both meaningfully and vice versa. Otherwise, they risk limiting their potential. We must also help our students understand what we know to be true, that any Stanford degree will enable them to lead a successful and fulfilling life. So alongside our great STEM alumni, including inspiring founders of Silicon Valley firms, let us also celebrate our alumni from other disciplines, philosophy majors such as Stephen Breyer, a Supreme Court justice, history majors like Dianne Feinstein, and political science majors like Cory Booker, both United States senators, English majors like Dana Gioia, California Poet Laureate, and France Cordova, director of the National Science Foundation, and drama majors like Sterling Brown, an Emmy-winning actor. It is, moreover, essential for us to maintain a vibrant student body with the full breadth of disciplines, because so much of what our students learn, so much of their education, comes from interacting with other students, not just their professors. Any narrowing would ultimately be impoverishing to all. Let us also help our students appreciate that not all learning need be applied to future jobs, and learning for its own sake is profoundly rewarding. My own mother is testament to this and an inspiration for the sheer joy of learning. She went on to earn her bachelor's degree after her children had grown up. We must further enrich our students' lives through beauty, in arts, in poetry, in the elegance of a scientific theory, in their surroundings, and through acts of service, both of which generate their own transcendent rewards. And as we consider how best to serve our students, let us explore the full spectrum from online and experiential learning to classroom design and augment their entire educational experience. I'll add one more challenge. As we discover new ways to prepare our students, as we experiment and evolve and improve our educational strategies, let us always consider how they can be shared and applied beyond our walls. I challenge us to be purposeful for Stanford and for the world. Let me now turn to our second pillar, the generation and application of knowledge. The pursuit of knowledge simply to understand ourselves and the world around us, is fundamental to the human character. But applying the knowledge we've learned to solve real-world problems is equally important. These two activities, the pursuit of knowledge and its application, are sometimes pitted against one another. They are the other two cultures. But our founders understood that nurturing both is essential for a purposeful university. History has shown that fundamental scholarship, driven simply by the investigator's desire to understand, is often the basis for the most transformative applications, and that applied research, in turn, regularly stimulates new avenues of fundamental inquiry. From its inception, Stanford has focused on both, and that has been a singular strength. But what are some of the issues we face in advancing this dual mission? Half a century ago, the value of fundamental research in powering both societal advances and economic prosperity was well appreciated. This century, financial support for such research has eroded, jeopardizing future transformative advances. Today, more than ever, fundamental research needs vocal and ardent champions, all of us. We also need to ensure that fundamental research and scholarship continues to flourish here at Stanford. That is a first priority. A second, complementary priority is to ensure that we are as effective as possible in the application or translation of knowledge. The interface between fundamental and applied research is not always efficient. Researchers involved in generating knowledge may lack skills needed for application. Those who are best at translating knowledge may not be aware of the latest fundamental advances. From its inception, Stanford has always fostered a culture of innovation and application and has been amongst the most successful institutions in bridging that gap, especially in tech fields. We've been assisted in this by our immersion in the culture of Silicon Valley, which Stanford Research and Stanford alumni helped create. But there's a great opportunity to further refine this process and extend it. In my own field of biomedical research, laboratory insights into disease processes often fail to get translated because of a lack of specialized infrastructure to create chemical precursors to therapeutic drugs. Making such facilities available to our scientists would accelerate translating discoveries from bench to bedside. Similar opportunities exist in other areas, and application isn't confined to the hard sciences. Many of our scholars in sociology, psychology, history, literature, and the arts have led real-world applications of research discoveries. Could we further improve the translational process in those fields and others as well? The third priority for our research mission, as for our educational mission, is to continue to ensure across-the-board strength in all disciplines. Increasingly, cutting-edge research draws on many disciplines and will not succeed without that breadth. And the examples of progress in engineering and science requiring the humanities, social sciences, and arts, and vice versa, are legion, as I've already alluded to. Only if we maintain strength and depth in all disciplines can we begin to address these and other consequential issues. That breadth will also enable us to multiply and accelerate our impact, as advances in one field can then be more readily applied to other disciplines across the academy. To leverage that breadth, we need to continue to break down silos and stimulate interdisciplinary research, building on the leadership of President Hennessy and Provost Etchemendi. I also want to highlight a fourth priority, which is to explore the moral, legal, and societal dimensions of our research output. With our deep engagement with technological innovation and our strengths in law, business, anthropology, ethics, and other disciplines, we are well positioned to evaluate and anticipate the social impact of innovations like artificial intelligence or genome editing, and to prepare society to respond. As a purposeful university, we must not only enable change, but also help understand change and manage change. Let us now consider our foundational strength, our people, and our culture. We have the most remarkable Stanford family, faculty, students, staff, and alumni. I've already commented on aspects of our culture, our optimism, our resilience, and our courage to evolve. I've also been struck by the warmth and collegiality of our community, and our culture of mutual understanding and respect has really stood out as I've met with you in town halls, student residences, and faculty receptions. And I'm inspired by the richness of our diversity. Last month, walking across campus, I met Andrew, Bianca, and Trevor, three research assistants. I asked for their advice, and they urged me to reach out to as many students as possible. They said there is no typical Stanford student. Stanford is a heterogeneous community with people of many backgrounds and experiences. Our embrace of diversity dates back to Jane and Leland Stanford, who created an institution that from the start was non-denominational and open to all genders and races, that would, quote, open an avenue whereby the deserving and the exceptional may rise through their own efforts. As the first member of my immediate family to attend college, the commitment to diversity, opportunity, and access is particularly meaningful to me. Stanford is committed to diversity. It is equally committed to the critical and open exchange of ideas and expression, as reflected in our motto, just cited by President Casper, the wind of freedom blows, die Luft der Freiheit weht. Free expression of ideas is key to our mission. As scholars, we question accepted notions in order to seek the truth. As educators, we challenge each other with ideas and opinions that may be very different from our own to open minds and stimulate intellectual growth. As an institution, we refrain from pronouncements that might impede this treasured exchange of ideas. Free expression and diversity are bedrock values for the university, but they require continual vigilance. We must continue to promote a culture where all opinions can be heard and respected, and the whole community can be enriched by understanding the experiences brought by those of different backgrounds and perspectives. Past efforts have dramatically improved student access through our need-blind admission policy, but we know more can be done. We've also made progress in diversifying our faculty, students, and staff, but more needs to be done there as well, especially in representation of women and minorities on our faculty, where we are still far from where we need to be. And we need to continue focusing on ensuring that everyone who joins our community feels they are a part of it, especially those from historically marginalized groups. Inclusion Inclusion must be central to our efforts in the coming decade. This starts with reaffirming our culture of civility and our culture of respect for the dignity of every member of our community, and includes a rejection of all forms of violence, including the sexual violence that has roiled our campus, for which we have zero tolerance. Sustaining a culture of free expression and mutual respect requires commitment from each of us. It also requires personal courage. I described earlier how my mother inspired me. Another person who has inspired me for his courage is our colleague Ben Barris, until recently chair of the Department of Neurobiology in the School of Medicine. Ben and I have been close friends for almost 3 decades. Ben has broken many barriers in his life, and he is one of the most courageous people I know. Today, he is demonstrating personal courage as he combats a life-threatening cancer with characteristic determination and grace. But he has always been courageous at every step of his academic and personal life. He challenged scientific dogma, successfully arguing in the face of intense skepticism for the importance of a frequently overlooked type of brain cell. He was also the first openly transgender scientist elected to the National Academy of Sciences. And he has written from his perspective about gender discrimination in science and been a tremendous advocate for women. That is the kind of courage we want to flourish here. When we have the courage to challenge ideas, embrace our differences, and learn from each other, our potential is truly unlimited. That is the power of diversity. When Jane and Leland Stanford looked to honor their only child, they envisioned a university that would advance society. And for the past 125 years, Stanford has been realizing that vision. It has flourished as a purposeful university that fosters education, research, and creativity for the benefit of humanity. I'm inspired by the mainstays that support our purpose: a broad education that will serve students throughout their lifetimes, the creation and application of deep knowledge, and our embrace of diversity and the open exchange of ideas. We are equally strong in optimism, resilience, and initiative if we maintain the courage to evolve and take the long-term view. That sense of purpose will enable us to push the limits and spur transformative progress. As we leave here today, I ask every one of you to join me in developing a bold vision for the future, a vision for Stanford in the 21st century that leverages all of our resources. That is our responsibility, to deploy Stanford's tremendous strengths and vast intellectual capacity for the benefit of humanity. Let us be inspired by the issues of our time. Let them lead us to the insights we need to chart our course for the future. Let us commit to being a purposeful university, a courageous university, a university of unlimited potential. Let us be fearless. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kyle, for that lovely piece of music, which, as Gerhard said, was clearly purposeful. I'm pleased to be here this morning and to have the opportunity to celebrate the inauguration of my successor, Marc Tessier-Lavigne. Now, Marc, Gerhard observed that your name may be the most difficult to pronounce among the 11 Stanford presidents. But you'll never be confused with an after-dinner drink. I have spent more than half of my life at Stanford. It has been my academic home since 1977. Before becoming president in 2000, I was fortunate to serve on the faculty during the tenure of three outstanding presidents, Richard Lyman, Don Kennedy, and Gerhard Casper. Each brought his unique talents to bear on the challenges of the time, giving us the Stanford we know today. As President Tessier-Lavigne said, a university is about the future. Of course, we build on the foundations of the generations who preceded us. But the work that we do is always about discovery, about advancing the boundaries of knowledge, or educating new generations of students who will make their own contributions to the world. This is particularly true for Stanford. As David Starr Jordan, our first president, said in 1891, at the opening of the university, the finger posts all point forward. Stanford has come a long way over its 125 years. Its impact is now felt worldwide. Its recognition as a global leader is the result of the work that we, the entire Stanford community, faculty, students, staff, and alumni have done together. When I was president, I was often asked about the challenges of leading Stanford, or as the alumni would put it, what really keeps you up at night. And while we have certainly come a long way, there are definitely new challenges. These range from the issues on our campus, such as eliminating sexual assault, to Bay Area issues, such as the high cost of living and our overburdened transportation system, to national challenges, such as our paralyzed political system, inequality of opportunity for youth, or lingering racism and discrimination. And global problems, climate change, terrorism, civil war, poverty and corruption, are even more formidable. Although these are difficult challenges, like President Tessier-Lavigne, I am fiercely optimistic that Stanford's great strengths can make a real difference. The incredible excellence of our schools, departments, and institutes, combined with our breadth of disciplines, position Stanford to be a leader. Furthermore, our ability to collaborate across disciplines and schools allows us to bring those strengths to bear in unique ways. And when it comes to developing creative, entrepreneurial approaches to difficult problems, Stanford is simply unmatched. Our Pacific Rim location, which in the earliest days of the university perhaps isolated us a bit, has endowed us with a sense of optimism and made us a bridge to the new world of Asia. But my greatest source of optimism comes from our students. They are absolutely determined to make the world better for themselves and the generations to come. If we are to contribute to a better future, we must balance our attention between the immediate problems we face and the long-term health and improvement of the university. As Dwight Eisenhower reminded us, what is important is seldom urgent. We need to remember that Stanford is one of a small number of institutions that can provide the knowledge and educate the talent needed to address the most important global challenges. Fortunately, Marc Tessier-Lavigne understands this, as his inspiring remarks have made clear. I have had the pleasure of knowing Marc for a number of years. I had a hand in recruiting him when he joined the Stanford faculty in 2001. And I know his remarkable qualifications as a scholar, as an educator, and as a leader. I share his optimism about the future of our university and its ability to be of even greater service to the world. From my perspective, he is eminently qualified to be Stanford's 11th president. And we are indeed fortunate that you, Marc, agreed to take on this challenge. I have great confidence that with our enthusiastic support, Marc will lead Stanford to new heights. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm John Etchemendi, University Provost, and I want to thank you all for joining us today. It's my honor and privilege to close out our ceremony this morning and to invite you all to a reception that we'll hold for Marc and his family in the main quad. But first, I'd like to share a story with you that I tell new Stanford parents after they drop off their children at orientation and are preparing to leave head home. Now, they're exhausted from the day's activities, and they're in need of reassurance about the university and about our commitment to their children. So I share with them excerpts from a letter that we received some years ago from an alumnus. The alumnus, a lawyer, visited an abandoned factory in downtown LA at about 6:30 a.m. for background work on a case. A janitor working there came over to talk to him because he noticed that the alumnus was wearing a Stanford baseball cap. In broken English, the janitor shared with the alumnus that his daughter had just graduated from Stanford, the first in her family to have attended college. In that most unlikely of places and times, these two men talked about how much Stanford meant to them and to their families. At the end of his letter, the alumnus wrote, quote, "My own dad dropped out of high school. He worked as a guard at Soledad Prison. I remembered this morning my dad's pride and joy in telling others that his son had gone to Stanford. That Stanford is special and that there is a Stanford family are not cute fundraising slogans. They are living experiences." I share this story this morning because I think we sometimes get so busy that we lose sight of how special this university truly is, and how privileged we are to be here. An inauguration, thankfully, gives us the opportunity to stop, to reassess, and to renew. Much has been said this morning about the origins of Stanford's success and about the values our university represents. I would like to add my own. I believe that any success Stanford achieves is due to its people and to the community that we cumulatively create. There's a strength of purpose here, a generosity of spirit, and a sense of connection that I have seen nowhere else. It creates the foundation of everything we do. We arrive here from all over the world in a delightful testament to diversity in its many forms. We're attracted to Stanford for many reasons. There's the weather, yes, but there are many other admirable traits that bring us here, including the university's ideals, the moving story of two grieving parents committed to helping other people's children, and Stanford's relentless pursuit of new knowledge. Those are just three of many. Whatever our reasons for coming, something happens to us while we're here. We are transformed. That happens whether we're an undergraduate, a graduate student, a postdoctoral researcher, a faculty member, a staff member, or a parent. We become something more, something better together as a community. And we carry that feeling of optimism and loyalty to the institution's values forever, wherever we go and whatever we do, just as the janitor and the alumnus in my story have. If we ever lose sight of that sense of community, there's somewhere we can go. The main quadrangle is something of a metaphor. The sandstone archways are like a warm embrace, especially when the sun burns the fog off in the morning and everyone is hurrying to his or her class or work. The architecture holds a visitor close when you are within, but it insists that we look outward from its sandstone embrace to the world beyond. The time capsules that line the walkways contain the hopes, dreams, and remembrances of those who came before. They hint in their unfinished progression of those who will follow. They're like a tap on the shoulder, reminding us of the legacy that we've inherited and must nurture going forward. And that brings me to my reason for bringing up the subject of community this morning. Community is a responsibility that requires constant affirmation. Community has to be renewed as the university grows and stretches with each new challenge and with each new member. We are partners in this shared Stanford experience. Partners watch out for one another, help one another, respect one another's contributions, and support one another. So let me conclude by welcoming Marc to our community in his new role as president. I hope, Marc, that you draw strength, inspiration, and encouragement from this community. I hope you find in it, too, as much challenge, excitement, and wonderment as I have since 40 years ago this fall, I first arrived here as a graduate student. Like everyone on the Stanford campus, I cannot wait to see how Stanford is transformed under your able leadership, and how you will be transformed by Stanford's embrace. Now, I hope that everyone will join us in a true expression of our welcoming community for a reception honoring Marc and his family in the main quad. Thank you again for coming.